of my mouth and the meditation of our heart here is pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Then there's this joke, if you will. There's a man who says, they say you should always dress for the job you want, not the job you have. Which is how I ended up in my supervisor's office, dressed like Batman. I don't like that joke. It says something about it. Anyway, it's not totally disconnected from today's gospel. The first thing to realize is who's Jesus talking to when he tells this parable of the servants getting prepared. And Peter actually sets it up for us really nicely, because he's turned to Jesus and says, who are you addressing in this previous story about, you know, if the owner of the house had not known what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. Which makes sense. If you know when someone's going to break in, you do something about it. But the whole goal is preparation. And Peter says, is that something you're saying to us, your disciples, or to the general people, the general assembled people? And sometimes Jesus' parables are general and sometimes they're specific. And Jesus responds to Peter with a very specific story about a servant who is left in charge of the household and who is then essentially has a choice. You're in charge. The master is gone for a time. This is addressed to the disciples. So back to the joke about Batman. In a sense, we want the job of Batman. We want to be disciples. That is, if you will, the goal of the Christian journey. To be a disciple of Christ. A disciple is one who is under the discipline of. But it's a very specific sort of discipline. It's a discipline of training so that you can go out and establish a new school back then. Jesus, amongst other things, a rabbi, a Jewish teacher, sort of technically. And what they would do is they'd have disciples. And the disciples would follow them under their discipline, learning to be as much as possible like their teacher. To the extent where they would learn to tell the same sermons or homilies or parables, even using their teacher's cadence, the pattern of speech that he used. It wasn't just the story, it was how he told the story. So that's our goal, in a sense, to be Batman, to be the disciples whom Jesus is addressing, which is quite a challenging thing here. Because in this story, there is what if the servant gets it wrong? And I don't mean makes a mistake wrong, because we all make mistakes. You know, it doesn't matter how amazingly awesome you are or not, everybody makes mistakes. But there are, if you will, flaws of character. There are approaches to things that are fundamentally not in the line that God would want us to take. That's not a mistake. That's not missing a meeting because you didn't put it in your diary properly. It's a very different thing. So when we look at the church, where have we gone wrong? It's an important thing to have a look back in our own history. And here's my thing. When we think the point of this organization that we're a part of, and it is an organization, is the organization, we have gone wrong. When we think the point of the church is to look after the church, we've lost the point. When we think the point of the the church is to look after the back balance. We've lost the point. When we think the point of the church is to make sure that the grass is nicely mowed and the place looks pretty, we've lost the point. We have approached this with a fundamentally wrong attitude. And Jesus says God is going to be cranky about that. Don't get me wrong, I don't have a problem with church buildings and bank balances and nicely mowed grass. But it's important that we understand those things as aids to the work that the church does, not the work that the church does. And the work that the church does is to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. We finish our readings for the gospel of the Lord. And gospel means good news. It's also a deeply political statement. That's a sermon for another day, I think. So this is good news. It sounds like it's not, doesn't it? It sounds like it's not good news, but it is. It's the same sort of good news that's implicit in a sign that says road flooded. Because that tells you something. Proceed no further or you will be washed away. That's good news. You want that sign. You don't want to come across a flooded road at 60 kilometers an hour. So that's a bad sign. So this is a warning sign. And a warning sign is still good news because it means we have a choice. It means you have a choice. It's just like, you know, roads flooded. People are foolish all the time. And they think, I can do it. I've got a big car. I'm tough. You know, whatever. I would have done it too when I was 22, 23. I would have been, I'll be fine. People make choices. The good news is we have both a warning sign and the option to make a choice. And our choice should be, because we know better, to be good servants of the master we have chosen to follow. Because we also know that if we don't, we don't even get to plead ignorance. You don't get to go, sorry God, I didn't know, because God will say, yes, you did. We have a choice, and that is good news. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.